Hi everyone, Mark DeJesus here. And what I'd like to do in this video is talk about the subject of mental health and do a fruitful consideration of your journey and the importance of recognizing life transitions. You see, I found in my own life and a lot of the lives of people I was helping, for example, in OCD, is that there were certain life transitions, certain periods of their life where the OCD symptoms seemed to arise intensely. And it came during a tricky life transition. I have a bunch of them here up on the board. I'm going to talk about them. What's a life transition? It's moving from one stage to another. It becomes a time where there's uncertainty, we're vulnerable, we need to be taught. There's a bunch of needs there that if those seasons are not surrounded by loving care and equipping, they can be very, very challenging. And so it's kind of like race car driving, right? When you watch a NASCAR or any kind of race car type of situation, what you notice is the key skill is in the turns, right? It's in those turns. They have a skill set to be able to handle the turn. Anybody could kind of put the pedal to the metal and just go straight. I know many could argue that that takes a lot of skill too, and it does. But see, that race is a very long race. And it's about how those curves and turns, the turbulent turns, are handled. If not, they become wipeout moments. And for many of us, we have wipeout moments in transition times that then many of these battles, maybe it's OCD, maybe anxiety develops or depression develops. A lot of depression forms out of these certain seasons that take a beating on our hearts. And many times we're stuck in like focusing on the mental brain faculties not working correctly, we don't take into consideration the heart. And in my work, in my passion, I'm always about getting people to focus on the issues of the heart, because when those areas are nurtured and brought into greater healing, it has a domino effect, right? So here's a bunch of life transitions I could talk about, but what we need in them is three main things. I could list a whole bunch, but three main things. In times of transition, we need loving, and notice I got the word loving here because it's got to be a part of all three of these. We need loving presence, meaning someone there for you. I'm here. I've got your back. I'm here for you. And this starts with mom and dad. Without a father's presence, loving presence in your life, these transitions can often be setups for a lot of stress, a lot of confusion, a lot of brokenheartedness, a lot of struggle. Without a mother's presence of equipping you, I'm here, you are loved, there's going to be so many spin outs that take place in our life and in our journey. So we need loving presence of having a sense that somebody's here. That also helps us to learn that no matter what, humans can fail, God is here with us. But many times our connection to His presence, we have a struggle because our history lacks a sense of references for what is it like to have someone in your life who's got your back, right? The second thing we need is nurture. Oh, we need nurture so much in these curves, these times, these turns. Nurture says it's going to be okay. Nurture says, I'm going to help you. Nurture says, I'm going to hear you express what you're going through. I am going to lovingly embrace you and help you to process through those things. So now you become emotionally equipped at the next stage. The third thing we need is crucial. You could have, you know, caring environments and some sense of structure in growing up, but what you need is equipping. It's like, okay, you're here, there's nurture. Now, nurture has equipping to it. But what I really need is, how do I navigate these times in our life? And so look at all these areas that I've put here. And this is just the start. These are just some main areas. Because I have found, and look in your own history, no condemnation, no shame. Just take an honest look at your journey and see if your battles that ended up moving into mental health struggles happened and really started to rise up during many of these seasons. Of course, the beginning starts with childhood bond. It's very critical in the early stages of development. A child develops healthy bonds with dad, a healthy bond with mom. If those healthy bonds are not formed, we'll have struggles bonding in life in all these other areas. It can develop dysfunctional connections. It's about the bond. So that's the key. When parents are parenting their children at the young age, it's about developing that bond, because that's the foundation the next stages develop out of. Because in these early years, they're developing emotional sense of, can I express how I feel? Am I loved? Am I safe? How do I develop my identity? Is unconditional love here? Do I have to earn love? Then there becomes a very, very critical stage right here, and that's entering the stage of puberty and moving into teen years, because now sometimes there's a challenging of what's been taught to you. There's figuring who you are. You're hearing the voice of peers around you. You're starting to have all these changes and shifts in your moods. You're becoming a woman, a girl moving into becoming a woman, a boy becoming a man. This is a critical stage where I find many people, they find, okay, during that time period, stuff kicked up in family, stuff kicked up in my life. Maybe there's some added traumas that begin to happen. Maybe trauma's already happened, right? This is a critical turn that needs loving presence, nurture, and equipping to patiently walk through. In fact, I encourage parents during this time, you often have to spend more time than usual navigating these years. And what often happens for people is in these turns, you're a teen, you're moving into teenage years, and you feel like you're on your own, and you're just left to your room, and you're navigating stuff by yourself. So that becomes a critical time. Then there's these transitionary stages of moving from elementary school into middle school. You may have, depending on where you live, different structures of how this works, but where I live in the United States, these are critical transitions. Elementary to middle school. Usually this one is a scary one, moving into that middle school stage, and this one right here. How is that for you? Most people I talk to, boy, those are difficult transitions, right? Then as you leave high school, it's a very critical moment in time of responsibility, being able to handle pressure, right? At that stage, are you equipped to begin leaving father and mother and begin establishing new steps in your journey, right? So you've got graduation, maybe potential college years, or maybe you go right to work. There's a sense of like now pressure that you learn to deal with. Maybe jobs and job changes that you have to go through. Figuring out, what am I going to be when I grow up? What do you need? Loving presence, loving nurture, and loving equipping needed in all of these. And many people already at this stage have really, really difficult turns where the turn led into a crash. I know for me, these were marked times. I went to a brand new school, whole different school culture, not just going from my elementary school to my middle school. It completely changed school in this stage. And then developing in these teen years. Oh, my goodness. So many questions, so many things going on. And it began brewing a lot of stuff in my heart that could have been tended to, but didn't. And then this was a very challenging stage for me because I had to grow up fast. I went right into ministry leadership. I didn't even have college years. I mean, I went to school while I was already in leadership. I was leading people that were old enough to be my parents in church. So that was such a sharp turn. I remember in that moment when I was hired on a church staff, and I remember people that were hearing the news about it, there was all these words of pressure, of like, oh, you better make sure you're prayed up. I remember somebody saying to me, oh, you better fast and pray. You better make sure your heart is right with God. And I was like, yeah, I better, right? So fear came in intensely. And I, in fact, traced the rise of OCD in my life in epic proportions right here at this stage in my life. And so why is that important? Are you trying to like perfectly document and, you know, get everything figured out? No. What it means is that this season of my life it does. It needs some attention and some ministry, some counsel, some processing, where I look back at that time and go, what did I emotionally need that maybe I didn't even realize at that time? But now looking back, what did I need? And what belief systems formed in the absence of loving presence, loving nurture, loving equipping? I didn't have that during that time. So I went to survival mode, perfectionism, performance. You better keep your stuff together. You better make sure, right? So it opened up my heart for anxiety. in epic levels. And it drove me into OCD patterns in many different ways. Relational OCD, guilt confession OCD, religious OCD, a bunch of different other ones, right? Because I understand transitions, I can recognize, oh, I need to see that time, not with shame, but with loving patience. What did Mark need at that time? Because here's the thing. Value systems form in these transitionary times, in these moments. Things like, I have to do things on my own. I'll always be alone. People won't love me. People aren't there for me. God doesn't care about me. God is angry with me. God, all these things. I will be abandoned. I'm unlovable. All these value systems get formed in the times of transition. And many of these moments in our journey are traumatic. The turns are traumatic, or a trauma comes into your life and jolts you out of a journey that you're on, and many of those traumas never get tended to. That nurturing presence, I'm here, nurture. Let's process what happened there. Let's help you be aware of your emotions and what went on. Let's help you to be able to connect to those things, and then equipping of how you can begin to take those belief systems and how can I begin to look at them with loving kindness and begin to form and develop new emotional beliefs, new emotional patterns, new perspectives, right? There's career, there's job changes, many people losing their job, or a financial struggle. I don't meet too many people that don't say they've had some financial struggle in their life. And those moments of like sudden, oh, I don't know if I can pay the bills. Oh, I don't know that I have enough income. Oh, I over my head. Those moments, what do they need? Loving presence. I'm here. Nurture. Process this out, and then equipping. How do we handle these kind of things, right? Then there's the transitions of even coming into realizing sickness is coming into your life of some form, and you've got to tend to that. What do you need? Loving presence, loving nurture, equipping during that time. Even many people write to me and say, well, when the pandemic hit, the COVID-19 panic hit, oh my, all these symptoms are beginning to manifest in my life. Many form excessive OCD, anxiety levels, panic attacks, right? And so what they need is they need loving presence. I'm here for you. Nurture. How do you process these times when uncertainty seems to rise? Where there are now new challenges that you have to face, new things, ways of approaching life, right? And when those loving things are there, you get strengthened, you get healed. But many times, people will get lost in their mental health battle. And then they're beating themselves up for having a mental health battle. And it's like, wait a second, during that time of transition, your emotions were overwhelmed. It needs some loving nurture. It's okay. These transitions moving into marriage. You're no longer just single, now you're married. When you got married, was there loving presence of, hey, there's tribe here, people here with you. Nurture, where you can process, hey, I'm struggling, I'm nervous, it's a big step. And equipping, how to step into it. Not that we're perfectly equipped. Many times we got to step in and learn. Then there's this transition, children come in. Then you're beating yourself up, I'm a bad parent, and all these stages. Many moms write to me about traumatic birth experiences or pregnancies that were just awful, or postpartum, right? Because after giving birth, it's like, get right back into life. You should have great energy and you should just snap right back. And then there's tons of shame and there's tons of guilt and there's self-hatred and all this stuff that rises up because this transition was difficult. Maybe it's just trials in life that came about. Just really difficult stuff. I talked about financial. Or what about retirement? Leaving a job and a career you've done for 30, 40 years or however long, and now you're moving into this like nothingness and you have this identity crisis that happens. What about job losses? What about geographic moves, right? I found it just to be a healthy, if you do this lovingly, I found it to be healthy to just look at my journey and look at the key transitions and ask yourself the question, what did I need in those moments? What did I truly need? And two, what are some of the beliefs that formed, the voices that formed, the thoughts that formed during that time that I've actually carried with me ever since? That would be the first part. And then I'll get into the second part of this exercise. So hopefully you took a minute to kind of look through that and maybe give yourself some more time to process through it, is to first look, okay, what was the most difficult life transition in the journey into where I am now? What was that like curve where I lost control of the wheel and just didn't have the loving presence, nurture, and equipping to handle that turn? Because you can't do this in shame. You can't do this in beating yourself up. It takes loving kindness, patience, the welcoming of the power of God's love to welcome you in. Now, many times what I tell people is the problem is not the problem. Now, this rings true a lot of times in areas like OCD, where you become focused on whatever that argument that you're trying to figure out is. But what it does is you don't always become aware of your heart. Because in that transition, your heart needed love, and OCD can become a survival mechanism to try to make you feel safe. So it could be getting your religious faith, spiritual lens just right, that perfectionism, right? Or getting cleanliness just right. So if you're not having any kind of sense of contamination in your life, then it's a sense of control that rises up, or imperfections, or your relational world, or your performance, or your achievement, all these things that get pressure put on. Many people will often express, "Oh, Mark, I'm having anxiety. I've had anxiety, or I'm having it in massive ways, or I'm having panic attacks," right? And I often have to lovingly process them in understanding their journey, and they look and go, "Yeah, over here, that happened, and I was like, oh, yeah, I'm fine. I just moved on from it." And that stuff just kind of got stuck underneath the surface, and now it's rising to the surface. It's coming up, and we don't know what to do because we don't have the equipping, the loving nurture, the loving presence to handle those things. Or many times we're going into depression. Many people don't even know they're experiencing depression. They're just wanting to get rid of those feelings, right? Like, how can I just feel better? How can I feel better? Well, the problem's not the problem. How have you been processing these stages of your life? Maybe the OCD and anxiety and depression is a signal issues of the heart need to be tended to. Loving presence, nurture, and equipping, processing through things in your heart, because we live in a culture that just moves from the next thing to the next thing to the next thing without proper evaluation or just processing. I'm not saying you got to be introspective, but we never take the time. You know, God, even in the beginning of creation, when he created everything, he created a day of rest, and he just looked at everything. He said, wow, this is good. Do we have times in our life where we pause and reflect? Not just in a bad way of the hardships, but even in a good way. No, we just move from the next thing to the next thing. So we're constantly just shaking off stuff and moving on, which I understand. We need to be aware of, there are times in life where we're not aware of what we really need in those moments. Now, I wrote under here expectations and estimation. And what I mean by that is what I find in my work, in my personal journey, my family, and the work I do in helping people, is we often overestimate what we can handle, right? You approach a day, you usually stack on more than you should. It's kind of a default setting. And we underestimate how stuff affects us. So you start your day and you go, kind of like, here's what I should be doing. And then you feel defeated because you didn't hit those marks. You're stressed, you're overwhelmed. And your expectation was way further than it should be. Then at the end of the day or the end of the week or end of the month or end of the year, you underestimate how those transitions I put on the board affected you. You just move, especially the younger years. In the younger years, we didn't even realize. We don't have a clue how those things are really impacting us. That's why it's not till your late 20s or even your 30s or even 40s or even 50s or even people write to me in their 60s and they go, why is it taking me so long? Because we usually don't understand how stuff affects us till down the road. So don't beat yourself up if you're later in life and now you're realizing stuff. It takes as long as it takes, because the commonality, we overestimate what we can handle, and we underestimate how stuff affects us. So what we want to recognize is, in those moments of transition, what did you need? What did you need? We want to begin to process that out. Sometimes it's helpful to just kind of have an exchange with yourself and allow God to minister over your heart, where you can begin to connect to some of those emotions of what you needed. And to be aware of, okay, what thinking patterns arose during that time? Were they like fear-based, like look around every corner because no one loves you, life is always going to be hard, everything's on your shoulders, you never do anything right. That's something to be aware of because that's what's needed in the healing process. We can sometimes go, God, fix my anxiety. God, fix my depression. God, fix my OCD. Why not go, all right, God, I'm not going to focus on the symptoms as much as allowing you in my heart. What does my heart need? And what did my heart need during those turns and tough transitions in life that need ministry too? I pray that this will be a helpful resource for your life, for your journey. I find that for me, if you're wanting to go into some next steps in this process, two resources I would recommend. One is the book, God Loves Me and I Love Myself, because it'll help you to process how you see yourself in the lens of the love that God has for you. Second book I would recommend is The Heart Healing Journey, because it will step by step bring the call to awakening you to live more freely from the heart and address issues from a heart level. So I pray that that'll be a blessing and a helpful resource to your life and to your journey. If you love these resources, go to markdejesus.com, subscribe to our mailing list, get updates on what's going on. You can also give a one-time donation or become a regular supporter, and all of that is greatly appreciated. Thank you so much. I'll see you in the next resource.